Very good afternoon, everyone. So we'll be talking about what is new in the eyelid tumor management now. Why this is important, all these things have been started basically because some tumors that we face may not be resectable always. So it was started for the advanced tumors, but many of the patients, they are not ready to undergo knife. So even in those cases, we can attempt this type of the new treatments. So I'll be covering all of this in brief. So like Dr. Raksha had covered, when we start with the infantile hemangioma, what is the management? Primary line, of course, oral steroids and the intraretinal steroid was. Then after the accidental discovery of the propranolol and then the proven results of propranolol, what we use most commonly is oral propranolol in the early stage. In such cases where there is urgency to treat to prevent amblyopia because of the mechanical ptosis, of course you can initially give steroids and then followed by oral propranolol. So these are the some cases which we initially manage with triamcinolol followed by the propranolol. Now this growth curve of the tumor, this is a natural history of capillary hemangioma, and why these phases are important. There is a stage of proliferation, plato and involution. Now when you are seeing a patient, you should try to identify by seeing the old photographs of the patient if available to know that which phase patient is in. So in case of proliferation, there is active growth. So oral propranolol and intralesional steroids, oral steroids, they do work well. But if it's in the stage of the plato, then your propranolol may not work. It's like a patient of 1.5 years comes to you, you are trying to treat for 6 months altogether, and the lesion is same in the size. Is because there is no active phase of the tumor going on, and you do need steroids if there is a bulky tumor. And in case of involution, like they said, sometimes it's best not to treat and just observe. It will involute on its own. Now going ahead with the basal cell carcinoma, as just now Dr. Fairuz described, that the most important is taking 4 millimeter margins and getting a frozen section done, and with the margin control you can remove all these tumors. Problem happens with the studies that are done that tell us that orbital excentration that we do for most commonly for the basal cell carcinoma, those basal cell carcinoma involve medial canthal region. And this medial canthal region carries two problems. First, they are easily metastasized. Second thing, they are difficult to reconstruct. And because of that, this medial canthal involvement of basal cell carcinoma need to be treated with something else, not only with your surgery. So there is a treatment called as ortho-voltage radiotherapy. So how do you do it? Basically, as per the size of the tumor that we have, you need to give the radiation. And how it goes, this is basically X-rays. There are low voltage X-rays. And there is a metallic target. Generally, they use a tungsten. And this electron rays, they are specifically focused on those area of the tumor with involving certain margin from the clinically visible tumor. It is total clinical judgment. And based on that, the tumor control rate that they have achieved, this was an article in 2009, they have achieved a tumor control rate of around 94%. So of course, if it is a non-resectable tumor, the low volt radiation does work. Now, basal cell carcinomas, which are periocular, smaller ones, and they are, if patient is not ready for the surgery, or sometimes patient is not fit for the surgery also. What we have is a topical therapy for the basal cell carcinoma now. It comes in the form of an ointment called as imiquimod. How exactly does it work? It works on the toll-like receptors, and it activates the interferon pathway. It also activates the innate and the cell-mediated immunity of the patient, and all of that leads to apoptosis. So the tumor cells are there, they undergo natural apoptosis after applying imiquimod. And how do you apply? It's very simple. You don't have to admit a patient for giving topical therapy. You just need to apply on the lesion, around the lesion, 5 days a week for 4 to 6 months. And it has very good results. Now again, for the basal cell carcinoma, if the patient like this comes, then of course young patient, you can resect, and it's a one-time surgery, and you then just keep a follow-up. But sometimes you do have older patients, or you sometimes have a multifocal basal cell carcinoma which are not resectable. They are not the candidates for the surgical option. So Again, I would like to go into the molecular pathway, which is known as hedgehog pathway. That's how it happens, is the patch gene, okay, leads to the transcription, and that's how the cells multiply. Now, this patch gene has control over it by a ligand called as a hedgehog ligand. In some patients, if this hedgehog ligand is gone, the control over the transcription of the cells is gone, and it results into the excess of transcription and thus the tumor. So this kind of a multifocal tumors, basal cell carcinomas, are seen in many old age patients, and in those cases, vismodegib is a drug that acts, and it basically blocks your transcription. So it blocks the last step of the multiplication of the cells, and it has been shown to be very useful. These are certain new drugs which are targeting the same pathway. They are yet to be in the clinical use. Now, moving ahead with the what investigation, sometimes diagnostic dilemmas are always there, and you cannot go ahead with the incision biopsy. Sometimes patient don't want admission, or don't want a bigger procedure. They just want to confirm that how are you sure about the diagnosis, and how can you go ahead with the excision without having some evidence of incision biopsy. Then doing an incision biopsy has become a daycare or OPD procedure with the punch biopsy. So there is a punch available which takes 2 mm by 2 mm bite of the tumor. And what are the advantages of that? It's a simple diagnostic, requires a little equipment, and the level of agreement is high with the conventional incision biopsy. So you don't have to admit the patient. It's a daycare procedure. Patient comes to your OPD, you are suspecting something. To have evidence-based medicine, you can go ahead with the punch biopsy, and it can give the same result as per your incision biopsy. Now, actinic keratosis. As all of you know, actinic keratosis is a pre-malignant lesion for the squamous cell carcinoma, and you do have a conjunctival, you do have a periocular component also, skin component also, of actinic keratosis. Treating this pre-malignant lesion, sometimes cosmetically, sometimes to prevent a further growth of the tumor, is important, and we do have a treatment available for this also. And again, going into this, actinic keratosis has 8% rate of progression into the squamous cell carcinoma. So we either have a topical 5% 5-FU, which causes inhibition of the thymidinase synthesis and has its own complications of topical application. And we do have a topical diclofenac gel also, which is known to work in cases of actinic keratosis. Problem is, topical diclofenac gel has less side effects, but less efficacy also in treating actinic keratosis. So what to use is generally depends on the long-term studies, as which works better in the long term. But the problem is, we don't have a recurrent study at present or any long-term study for the actinic keratosis treatment with the diclofenac or the 5-FU. But both do work equally well. Now, as we see a patient, we know we need to divide into the AJCC-TNM classification and then accordingly treat it. Now, there is a big role of, like Madam said, the micrometastasis. Micrometastasis, whatever squamous cell carcinoma you are seeing, basal cell or the sebaceous gland carcinoma, they do metastasize to the lymph node in the early stages, which you might not come to know till the tumor in the advanced stages. So in those scenarios, the sentinel lymph node biopsy is recommended. So how do you go ahead with the sentinel lymph node biopsy? It's basically lymphoscintigraphy. What you do is you inject a 0.2 ml of the technetium dye on the peritumoral region, and then capture it with the gamma camera and try to see which lymph nodes are involved. So this can be done either pre-surgical management, or it can be done at the time of the surgery also. What you do is, whatever lymph nodes are involved, the biopsy of the first 5 lymph nodes has been taken, it has been given to pathologist, and if this biopsy is negative, it gives you a confirmation that at the time of the surgery there is no micrometastasis and less likely it to have a further. So there are certain indications for which you need to do a sentinel lymph node biopsy. Even if you don't do prior, it can be done at the time of the surgery. So the indications that has been put forward are if you have a sebaceous gland carcinoma, which is more than 10 millimeter, melanomas, which is more than 2 millimeter thick, or any eyelid melanoma, which is more than or equal to 1 millimeter, Merkel cell carcinomas, or squamous cell carcinoma, which are more than 2 centimeter. All these cases, you can do a sentinel lymph node biopsy. Now, squamous cell carcinoma, again a non-resectable variety of the squamous cell carcinoma. There is a drug which has been approved and passed its phase 2 clinical trial is cetuximab. It's a EGFR inhibitor and it's again given with the oral dosage with weekly infusions. And this is known to work very well in cases of the squamous cell carcinomas which are unresectable. So there are lot more drugs getting developed. This is the advanced management is all about the tumors which are non-resectable, and it is known to tolerate well in all these scenarios, even in the older patient. Like it was shown that sebaceous gland carcinomas which are larger can be chemo reduced initially and then can undergo the surgical resection. As we have moved ahead, we know the OSSN primarily nowadays is managed with the topical chemotherapy or topical immunotherapy instead of going ahead with the surgical resection. So there are multiple new treatment modalities that are coming in the lid tumors and the surface tumor, and as ocular oncologists, we need to be aware of that. And all the patients, even in the advanced stages, are still treatable with very good prognosis. I would like to thank you all, and if there are any questions, all the speakers are available here. We still have 5 minutes more to start the next session. So any questions can be answered.